Hello everyone, a very good morning to all of you. Myself Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So guys, before moving on to the questions, let me inform you that the PDF of this session is downloadable and the link is in description below. So let's begin with our first question, which is really a very interesting question because this report in itself is very, very interesting. So what will be India's GDP at constant prices in 2036 as per CEBR's World Economic League Table 2022. So as I told you that this report is in itself a very, very interesting report. So why did I tell you this? Because this report tells us the scenario of 2036, which country will be at which position, which economy I should say, will be at which position. Do you know that this report tells us that India will be the third largest economy of the world by the year 2031, and it will continue to stay as the third largest economy by 2036 also. So this is why I told you that it is very interesting. So as per this report, the real GDP of India in the year 2036 would be US$7,099 billions. Okay, so option A is the right answer. Now guys, here some of the facts are very quantitative in number, quantitative in nature, therefore you need to memorize those facts, but other facts are very basic in nature, so you can just understand them as well. I'll try my best to make it comprehensive for you all so that you don't have to mug up all the data that is present here. Okay, so first of all, the report is released by Center for Economics and Business Research, which is a UK based consultancy, economic consultancy company. Okay, now from the table itself, it is very evident that this economic table league has tracked the situation, the economic position of countries from 2020 to 2036. Actually, they have also taken into consideration data prior to 2020, but I specifically picked out from 2020 to 2036 because nobody is going to ask you the relative economic position of India in 2005 or in 2011 per se. So I have picked the data from 2020. So at present, USA is the number one economy and it will continue to stay so by the year 2026. But China is poised to take over USA by 2031. And then China will be the world's largest economy till 2036. Now we can foresee the data till 2036 only as per this report. Okay, so China and US are sorted here. Next comes Japan and Germany. Okay, so here we can see that Japan is number three till the year 2026. So US and Japan are the close the relatives, we can say, because love and hate relationship tha inke beech mein, and right now they are close allies. Okay, so US and Japan, both of them are seeing a decline in their position by one position. USA is going to move to second position, whereas Japan is going to move to fourth position in 2031. Then Japan will further deteriorate to fifth position by the year 2036. Okay, so I hope that you can memorize Japan as well. Now comes Germany. Okay, the Hitler country. I should not say this, the Hitler country, but it's the fact that Hitler was the ruler of Germany and the ideology that Hitler held was so modernized, or we can say that he was a megalomaniac. He wanted Germany to be the world power. Now let's see how far his dream has come true in terms of the economic table, in terms of the economic position that Germany has held so far. So Germany is the fourth largest economy. In 2020, it will continue to stay so till 2026. So you can see the position that the countries are having in 2020 will remain same till 2026 for some countries. For some or two, one or two countries, it will change as we can see here. So as far as Germany is concerned, which is the fourth largest economy, the position will downgrade to fifth largest. Then it will become the fourth largest in 2036 by surpassing Japan. Okay, Japan here is the fourth one, then Germany will take over Japan. Then comes UK, fifth position at present, and by 20 26, Japan, UK will be at the sixth position and it will continue to stay so till 2036. For UK, it is very easy. For 3 years, it's 5. And for the upcoming 3 years, it's 6. Okay, no change at all. France, 6 till 2021. Okay, so this is the year in which we are living, which is about to end in 2022. Now, guys, pay attention to this thing that all of these are financial years. Okay. So pay attention to this fact also. France is going to stay at the sixth position, then it will remain at the seventh position from 2022 onwards, largely due to the impact of Corona as well. Okay. But this table, this report forecast that even after the impact of the Corona will recede, then also France is poised to remain at the seventh position because India is supposed to take over France in the year 2022. Next year only, India is going to become the sixth largest economy of the world. Then we will become fifth largest by 2026, by 2031. We will become third and remain third largest till 2036. Now, guys, the positions of 2036 are very important. Therefore, I have put it in a separate table as well for you all for your convenience. You can just memorize the sequence from here also. Now, let's discuss about India in detail. So, the very first thing that we have is GDP in local currency in billions, okay, at constant prices. So, this is the real GDP, I hope. That you all know the basic difference or the division of GDPs. We have GDP at MP, at market price. This is the GDP on which we compare. We have GDP at factor cost. This is the real production. This is the real GDP of the country. And this all the market price GDP also includes indirect taxes. Further, in this only, we have two demarcations, real GDP, which is the GDP at constant prices, and nominal GDP, which is the GDP at current prices, which also considers the inflation. Okay, so I hope that this much you all know. I'm not going into the details of it. Guys, do you know that what is the base year of calculating real GDP in India? This is your question. Do mention it in the comment section below. So, the real GDP in Indian currency by the year 2036 would be 359,000, would be over 359,000 billion rupees. Okay, so this is the digit, this is the GDP. Now, you don't have to memorize the unit digits as well, you can just memorize this much only. Okay, as far as the GDP in US dollar terms is concerned, it is 7099 US. 7,099 billion US dollars. In terms of current prices, it is, again, it is in the US dollar terms, 10,761 billion US dollars. Some more facts about India. So India's PPP adjusted GDP per capita, that is purchasing power parity adjusted GDP per capita, is US dollar 7,340. Then the status of India is lower middle income country. This is the very common fact that we all know. GDP growth rates that this report has forecasted for India for 2020 to 2021, it's the real growth rate, rather the contraction rate, which is 7.3%. For the upcoming year or the current financial year 2021 to 2022, it is 8.5%. This is the estimate. Now, this is 0.6% above the 2019 levels. But do you know what is the growth rate of 2019? It is 4%. Then how is it only 0.6% above than the 2019 level, where we can obviously see that it's almost double the growth rate of 2019. So guys, here, it's a very basic trick, a very basic understanding. If you look into it in very detail, okay, let me tell you this thing. This rate is so much high. This is not indicating the increase in production. Okay, in actuality, India's production has not increased by 8.5%. This much growth rate is the result of the COVID pandemic. Last year, we had the negative growth rate. And in comparison to that, if we see the growth rate of this current financial year, then it is 8.5%. Therefore, only if you had paid attention to the GDP growth rates, there were agencies that were forecasting over 10.1% GDP growth rate for India. Some have also forecasted GDP growth rate of up to 14% for India for the current year. But has our production increased by 14%? Is it the reality? No, this is not the reality. This is indicating the impact of the negative growth rate that we have seen in the corona year, that is 2020 to 2021. That's why it is 8.5%, and it is just 0.6% above the production levels that were there in 2019. So in terms of real, if we want to see the real picture, real increase in the income of India, then the real increase in percentage terms is just 0.6%, okay, of 2019 levels. Now, the next point is that your share in global GDP, global greenhouse gas emissions is 7%. Okay, so this is also important for India because we have committed to become net zero by 2070. We have also committed to have 500 gigawatts of energy generated from the renewable energy sources, etc., etc. The Panch Mitra that we have already announced at the COP26. I hope that you all remember those five targets that India has announced. So in order to have sustainable economic growth, this is the present GHG emissions which we need to focus on to reduce. Okay. COVID versus economic struggle. So the next, this is the next headline. So deaths that India has recorded is 4.5 lakhs, over 4.5 lakhs. Now this is just the estimate. Absolute number has not been given by the government. We all know what is the ground reality. The numbers that the government is saying that these many people have died due to COVID are not the actual number. However, they are doing so because of the panic. If they tell the real number, then obviously panic will be created in the market, in India also, in generally among the people. Therefore, this is the number that we have got of deaths in India. But still, we are the third largest country to have witnessed so many deaths due to the COVID-19 after US and Brazil. In total, the total share of vaccination is 34%. So this is the fully vaccinated people, 34%. Okay. And the share of the people who have at least one dose of vaccine is 57.4%. This is very much in line with the global standards provided by WHO. Foreign investment is also going to enhance. India is witnessing strong foreign domestic investments in 2020 to 2021. However, very recently, we have seen that rupee has become the Asia's worst performing currency, and the one of the components that have contributed towards the decline in the value of rupee is the outflow of foreign money from the Indian markets. But still, this report is saying that in 2020 to 2021, India has received good amount of foreign direct investment. However, this is also true because the outflow is happening now, but we are considering the entire years till now. Okay. So that was the report. I hope that you have understood it well. Moving ahead, now I'm not going to take so much time in each and every question. That was a very interesting report. Therefore, it stretched a bit long. So the next question is, under which scheme is the Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship sponsoring the project Umbar of NSTC? So guys, here the right answer is Scheme Sankalp. First of all, the full form of Project Ember is Accelerated Mission for Better Employment and Retention, and it was launched by National Skill Development Corporation with Generation India Foundation. So guys, this program is the basic, we can say, is the brainchild of these two organizations, and they are administering this project only. Okay, Ministry of Skill Development is just providing the funding for this project under the Sankalp scheme, skills acquisition and knowledge awareness for livelihood promotion program. Now guys, this scheme has been covered in the PIV many times, in government schemes videos also it is there. So I'm not going into the details of the scheme, but this scheme is important. Particularly, it is again in the news. That's why I'm saying you have to prepare the scheme thoroughly, and the scheme is already provided in the government schemes document. So under the scheme, the funding will be provided. The basic purpose of the scheme is to equip the youth with the industry relevant skills. We see there is a huge gap between the education system of India and the requirements of the industry. So this gap is being filled up by the schemes like these. Okay, so they are going to make youth equipped with skills. They are going to provide skill training to the youth. Now, how many youth are being targeted? 30,000 youth, of which 50% shall be women. Now, also remember that you can witness a question out of this statement in your examination if a question on Project Ambar is there. Okay, so BlackRock Foundation and McKinsey and Company, these two organizations are supporting this project. Now, in terms of support, they can provide technical assistance or whatever support is required by the NSDC and this GIF. Now, the training will be done under the Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Kendras, okay, which are across 70 districts. Now, guys, pay attention to this thing that the funding is being done under Sankalp scheme, but the training centers or the training is provided at the Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Kendras. Both of these are two different schemes, okay, and the project is altogether a different project, that is Project Ambar. So I hope that you won't confuse all these things, you won't mingle up. So in order to have this clarity in your mind, you need to revise it again and again. I'm just repeating myself that the Project Ambar is different, funding is being done under the Sankalp program, and the training will be provided under the Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Kendras. Okay, so these would be the centers, and these are the skill centers in which youth will be trained. Now, you are not required to memorize these skill sectors. Where is India's first international arbitration mediation center located? So it is located in Hyderabad. This was the inauguration. This is N.V. Ramana, CJI of India, and the Chief Minister of Telangana. Both of them are inaugurating the center. Where was the National Conference on Investment Opportunities in Highways, Transport and Logistics held? So it was held at Mumbai, and during this conference, four most important MOUs have been signed, which can become a question in your examination. So let's have a look at the MOUs. First one was signed between National Highways Logistics Management Limited, Maharashtra Industrial Development Corporation, and Rail Vikas Nigam Limited to establish multimodal logistics parks at five locations in Maharashtra, and those locations are Mumbai, Pune, Aurangabad, Nashik, and Dighi Port Industrial Estate. So at these five places, multimodal logistic parks will be established. Second MOU was Maharashtra Government and Tata Motors for setting up the registered vehicle scrapping facility. Third MOU was also for vehicle scrapping facility, but here the organization is different. It is Cooperative Energy Recycling and Organics, CERO. It is also India's first organized vehicle recycler. So CERO is important, and both of them have signed the MOU to set up additional vehicle scrapping facility in the state. The fourth MOU is of the most importance out of the MOUs that we have discussed so far. Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, IIT Madras, and MapMyIndia have signed an agreement for collaboration in driver and road safety technologies to reduce road accidents. So all these three entities are going to develop technologies that can help the drivers in preventing, in cautiously driving firstly, and secondly preventing road accidents. Now, a step towards this achievement or this goal only, these organizations have jointly launched a navigation app. Okay. So this navigation application service is basically provides alerts to the drivers whenever there is any kind of accident prone zone coming up, speed breakers, sharp curves, potholes, etc., so that they can become cautious beforehand and no accident takes place. Another additional information here is that MapMyIndia had also won the Atmanirbhar App Innovation Challenge in 2020. Okay, since this challenge is in the news, I hope that you will prepare this thoroughly. Moving ahead, Where is Islamic Development Bank located? So it is located at Jeddah, Saudi Arabia. Okay. Why is it in the news? Because Organization of Islamic Cooperation has held a summit in Islamabad to provide aid to Afghanistan, and they have decided to set up a fund to help the humanitarian crisis in the in Afghanistan by using the funds from Islamic Development Bank. Now, as far as the OIC is concerned, so the headquarters is in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia, and the members are 57. Now, guys, there is an important fact here that this organization is the second largest organization after UN with so many members. Okay, so here the comparison is on the basis of the member states. Okay, however, UN has 193, it has only 57, but still, this is the second largest organization to have so many member countries. So, this is the time for the GK Factory section. I hope that you all are excited enough to start this section. Bored to nahi ho gaye ho? I hope that you are not bored till now, because guys, a lot of interesting things are coming up. So I'm just recharging your energy right now. So here we have Aditya L1 Mission. Are you thinking that this is the topic of GK Factory for today? So here, stop your thinking. This is not the topic. This is the additional fact. This is basically the preparation, the base I'm preparing. So keep your curiosity on, okay? Keep increasing your curiosity. Let me tell you first that this Aditya L1 mission is India's first solar mission that will be launched in the third quarter of 2022. Okay, that's the proposed date. And along with this Aditya L1 mission, basically not along with the with this Aditya L1 mission, we are also launching this XOSAT observatory, but these two are just coinciding with each other. The launch dates of these two missions are just coinciding. It is not that they are going to be launched on the same launch vehicle. No, they are just coinciding. Okay, so at the same time, India will launch its second space observatory, which is XOSAT. Now, this will help Indian scientists to study the phenomena of pulsar and supernova. What is pulsar star? What is supernova star? I hope that this question is there in your mind, and if it is there, then you are on the right path. Okay, so moving ahead, spacecraft in the Aditya L1 mission will be sent 1.5 kilometer away from the Earth to L1 Lagrangian. Okay, so let me first tell you what is this. Basically, between the Sun and the Earth, there is a point called L1 Lagrangian. Okay, so this point is basically a point where the gravitational pull of both Sun and Earth become equal, and equal on the object, on the satellite. Okay, here the satellite is this Aditya L1 satellite. Okay, so on the gravitational pull on the satellite will become equal. So this is basically a kind of parking space in the space. Okay, so here Aditya L1 mission satellite will be placed, and from here the Aditya L1 will study the Sun's atmosphere, will study the origin of the universe, and etc. Now this position has been chosen so that the impact of the eclipse would be prevented from this mission. Okay, so even if it is eclipse on Earth, Aditya L1 can study the phenomena of Sun. That's why we have chosen this point, Aditya L1 Lagrangian. Okay, so this is a bit difficult to pronounce for me. Okay, so that is all that is written here. You can read it on your own when you will get the PDF. Okay, now Gaganyaan mission will be launched in 2023. So this is another mission coming up, a very important mission. Therefore, I have mentioned it also. Earlier, it was about the end of 2022, but it has been delayed. XOSAT observatory, I have already told you. So it will study the concepts like pulsar, star, and supernova. Now, this observatory satellite will be launched on small satellite launch vehicle, which is in the developmental stage. Now, guys, this is an observatory, but it is a kind of satellite that will be launched in the orbit. And from the orbit itself, it will observe the phenomena and then report back the data to the Earth. So that's the entire concept of XOSAT observatory. which has the same launch time as of Aditya L1. Okay, do remember. Now guys, this is the list of solar missions that have been sent by different organizations across the world, or countries we can say. So this is the first phase. Now let me first tell you that all of these pictures that I'm going to show you now have been taken from the Wikipedia, the tables. Okay, I'm talking about these tables. So I have verified the information, the launch years of these missions. So you don't have to worry about the authenticity of the tables of the missions, but at the same time you are not required to memorize. Okay, so don't sit and memorize these mission name, because these were launched before 1960, in the era of 1960 to 69. Right now nobody is going to ask you about Pioneer 5, 8, 9E. Nobody is going to do that. I'm just showing you this table for a very specific purpose, that is to make you, to help you guess the exact topic that I'm going to discuss today. So here we have the five missions to the sun. Next, we have again the missions to the sun that were launched during 74 to 97. So you can see here Germany is involved, NASA, European Space Agency, all of these are involved. Next, we have 2000 till present. So here we have so many missions. Out of so many missions, the most important mission here is the Parker Solar Probe that has gained success in entering the sun's outer layer corona, which is the history in the human history, which is very historic in itself. Okay, so that was all. And the proposed mission is the India's mission Aditya L1 to the sun. Now I hope that you have guessed it. Yes, it is about sun. So we all know that sun itself is a star, but have you ever wondered what is the life cycle of a star? How is it, how a star is formed? Okay, so I'm going to talk about that only, and there only we will also learn what is pulsar and supernova, because pulsar and supernova, both of them are stars. We will also learn what is nebula. So these are some of the terms that you come across in the news, in spotlight also many a times, but many of you would have just doused your curiosity at that moment that what is nebula, etc. And even if you have searched it, many a times it happens that we do not understand what the concept is all about. So today I try to make it easier for you. Okay, so let's begin our learning about stars. Okay, so I'm going to keep it short because already the video has stretched till 27 minutes. I'm not going to stretch it more. First, we have molecular clouds, cloud of loose gas. Now, there is gas in the galaxy, in the universe, and that gas is hydrogen and helium. Okay, primarily hydrogen is there. So for initially, there is a loose cloud of gas and dust, which slowly and gradually comes together and forms the cloud. And this cloud, my friends, is known as nebula. So many times we see that a nebula is seen by the astronomers in India or in NASA. So we come across news related to nebula. So this is the nebula. So this is the very primordial stage of a star. First, there is loose gas and dust in the universe. Then they come across, form a cloud. This cloud is known as nebula. Then when these gases come together, they start to fuse. Okay, they start to move together. Then hydrogen, the nuclei of the hydrogen fuse with another hydrogen's nuclei, and thus it transforms into helium. And through this nuclear fusion process, heat and light is generated. And when heat and light is generated, it becomes a star, because the very primary definition of a star is that it has its own heat and light. And the heat and light is coming from the nuclear fusion of hydrogen, which is transforming itself into helium. That's the process of a star. But here it does not end. It has a life cycle, guys. So it's just the birth. What about the end? We are going to discuss that also. So here we have the star. Sun is also a star. It has its own light and heat. But the star, okay, I forgot to tell you one thing, that we have hydrogen plus helium. But in which form is it present in a star? Is it purely the gas? No, the form is the plasma. Okay, so plasma is basically the thing of which a star is made up. Okay, and plasma is a semi-liquid, semi-solid form. We all know what kind of plasma, what plasma is. Okay, I hope that you all know the volcanic eruption. The lava that comes out is also a plasma. So similar to that, the sun is made up of plasma. So the plasma contains two gases, hydrogen and helium. This is a very basic question. It can be asked. So do remember, but there would be a time when this entire fuel of a star gets exhausted. What happens then? Then when the 90% of the fuel of a star is consumed, then it converts into a red giant. Red giant is again a star. Okay, so we are talking about stars, so it has its own light and heat. Still the light and heat is there, but the 90% of the fuel has already gone. So obviously the light and heat would be reduced, would be less in comparison to the star that it was actually. Do you know that sun is also going to become a red giant? That means 90% of the fuel of sun would end, would be exhausted. But by which year? By the time it will happen, we are not going to be on Earth. It would be after 5 million years. Okay, so you don't have to worry about it, whether we will get the sunlight or not, and what is going to happen with the International Solar Alliance that we are so pushing forward. Nothing is going to happen because it is still going to take a lot of time to become a red giant, when it will have a very less amount of heat and light, which in comparison to the present situation. Okay, so red giant. One another important peculiar feature of this is that the size of this star is expanded. Okay, so they start to expand, the gases start to expand, so the size becomes larger than the star itself. Then the stars are of two types: either they are larger or they are smaller. Larger stars have a different course of action or different life cycle. Smaller stars have a different life cycle. But how can we determine which star is larger or which star is smaller? Because the galaxy is full of stars. So how can we measure it? We measure it in comparison to sun. And for that, we have a very genius person who has given this limit. This is the Indian-American mathematician, Chandrasekhar, Subramanian Chandrasekhar. So he has given the Chandrasekhar limit. Okay. So this Chandrasekhar limit is basically the limit of the star, is the basically the size of the star in comparison to sun. If the size of the star is 1.4 times bigger than the size of the sun, then it is a bigger star. Okay, then it will follow another path. But if vice versa happens, sun is bigger and the star's size is 1.4% lesser, 1.4 times lesser than that of the mass of the sun, then it is a small star. It is going to follow a different path. I hope that it is clear. Now let me inform you that this limit I have taken from NASA's website. Okay, I'm stating this fact here because there on some websites like Wikipedia and Baiju's also, I found that the limit mentioned is 1.44. okay, and this is the NASA's website from where I have exactly picked up 1.4 times limit. Okay, so do remember this thing. So let's have a look at the small star, how the small star ends up. So a star is there, red giant is there. So this is the same stage that both small and large stars have to go through. Then after the 95% of the fuel of the star is lost, it becomes a white dwarf star, which is also known as the fossil star. Okay, so the light and the heat of the star is very, very less. And let me tell you that many astronomers have rejected white dwarf as a star. Okay, they do not acknowledge white dwarf as well as the black dwarf, okay, as star. Black dwarf ka to banta bhi hai. There is no heat and light in black dwarf. The entire fuel is consumed, so it is not a star. But this is something that the experts confirm to reject. They do not acknowledge this as the star. Moving ahead, so we have come across the life cycle of the small star, what happens to a big star, which is bigger, 1.4 times bigger than the sun. So this is the star. In star, I have taken all the images of suns because no exact picture, no clear picture was there on the Google of a star. Okay, they were showing us galaxies as if we are asking about galaxies. Sometimes Google does not work properly. Okay, so red giant to banega hi, but after becoming a red giant, when its fuel is consumed up to 95% of its limit, it becomes a supernova. So this is the supernova. So in order to study the supernova and pulsar, now what is pulsar? I'm going to tell you that ExpoSat is going to be launched by India, okay, to study this supernova. So it is basically the situation of the star when 95% of the gas within the star is lost. Okay, what happens then? It explodes. Okay, so in frustration, it explodes. It does not happen because of frustration. It's the basically the phenomenon. Now, this is the picture of the biggest supernova that astronomers have found so far. Okay, so this is the explosion of the supernova star. Then these are the four stages. Now, supernova has blasted. After blast, it can become a neutral star. Okay, so this is basically a neutral star. I hope that it is visible. Basically, it does not have any positive or negative charge. Either it can become a pulsar star, okay, or a quasar star, or a black hole. Now, do pay attention to this thing that after explosion, this does not become all of these, okay? One supernova explodes and become any one of these, not all of these. ऐसा नहीं होता कि explode हुआ तो within from one supernova there is one pulsar, there is one quasar, there is one neutral star, there is one black hole. No, any one out of the four would be formed out of one supernova blast. Okay, so do pay attention to this thing. Now I have told you that the neutral star does not have any charge, so that's the speciality. Pulsar star and the quasar star, both of them have a very very high speed of moving, so that's the speciality of these two types of stars that forms out of supernova. Again, I am repeating that not all of them are formed out of one supernova blast. One supernova will blast and it will become one of these, okay, not all of these. Next is black hole. Either it will become a black hole, and I hope that you all recognize this picture. This is the very first picture of a black hole that the humans have taken. Okay, so this is the real black hole. Now, related to black hole, now I hope that you have understood how a black hole is formed. I'm going to tell you some facts, very interesting facts related to black hole. First of all, it has a very high density. Very high weight, gravitational pull is also very very high. That's why it gulps everything that comes across its path. Okay, now why does it happen? Ye sab to I know that you all know that the density is very high, so much high that the one spoonful of the soil of this black hole would be equivalent to the weight of 10 elephants. That's the truth. But why is it so? The reason is that this much big of supernova has blasted and then it has compressed to this much of size. Therefore, the black holes are very small in size. And due to being the smallest in the size after the explosion of supernova, their density becomes very high. Because of the high density, their weight increases. And because the weight have increased, the gravitational pull has also increased. So that is the reason. Because of the explosion, this much of big, now this is not the exact size, supernova becomes compressed and become the black hole. Okay, so it is the very smallest of all the types of stars that can form out of supernova, or the smallest of the types of stars that are found in the universe. So that was the history of black hole. That's the whole idea behind a black hole. Now this picture has a very overview of the life cycle of a star. but you can yourself see that it is not providing you the detail, but I have put it here to give you a summary kind of a thing, so you can go through it on your own. Now this is the last slide. These are all stars. This one is the sun. These are also the stars. This is the blue star, this is the white star. Although we cannot see them, but still they are there. Now what is the reason behind the change in color of these stars? Guys, the reason is the temperature. Okay, the very high temperature star has a blue color. The star which has medium temperature has a white color, and star which has the low temperature, lowest of all the stars, has this red color, and the sun has the very low temperature. But what is the exact low temperature? It is approximately 6000 Celsius. Okay, degree Celsius. Approximately, okay, it's not the exact temperature. So here this video ends. I hope that you are excited to know the facts that I have told you, and if you are, then do not forget to subscribe to the channel, hit the bell notification. Thank you so much guys for watching the video.